station and this station.
Here's a Mornings with Mike Winters fun fact. The catfish has over 27,000 taste buds. Do you think they prefer fried or blackened? Here's Mike Winters.
I'd say fried, but that's just me. Although, I will tell you this, I love fried. I'm not a cornmeal fried guy. That's why catfish, I don't know what it is. Beer batter it for me. I don't know what it is. The cornmeal, something about my gritty in my teeth. Not a fan of it. But anyway, that's my own problem. Good morning. It is 20 minutes after 8 o'clock, and joining us in studio this morning from the New Mexico Shooting Sports Association, John Thosen, back with us. Good morning.
Hey, Mike. How you doing? Good to be back.
It's glad to have you back here. How's life been treating you?
Pretty good.
It's good deal.
Crisp fall morning we've got here.
Yeah, I imagine you feel this weather, and I'm sure there's a lot of hunters like, man.
Oh, yeah.
Tis the season to go out amongst the wilderness and see if we can bag an elk or a deer for the fall here.
That's a good time of year to do it.
Absolutely. So, I guess before we kind of talk about things that are coming up and all that, give folks a little bit of background about what the New Mexico Shooting Sports Association does. And obviously, you know, you hear part of it, you're probably pretty familiar with some of it, but don't realize that you kind of are the eyes and ears too for, you know, the legislative side of things in New Mexico when it comes to guns and rights and things like that. It's not just the fun part. It's the, you know, the rights and protecting and preserving that side of it too.
Right. We've been around since 1934, and we are the state affiliate for the NRA. So we do look out for your rights as gun owners. And we also promote shooting sports across the state, keeping people advised of events and, mm-hmm. and things like that. But right now, the last few years, the state is where the action is. You know, it used to be nationally with gun control, but here lately, what's going on, it's all pretty much at the state level. So we've got to be engaged, and we've got to be ready to fight at the state level. And that's what we're helping to do with New Mexico Shooting Sports.
And I'm guessing for folks that, you know, I mean, if you've lived here, you know how our state generally leans when it comes to policies and politics and things like that. So I would imagine you guys probably have your work cut out for you here in New Mexico as far as preserving, protecting gun rights for citizens.
We do. I want to talk about a meeting, but before we do, just as we speak, this afternoon, our slippery politicians are having a meeting in Santa Fe to take away our gun rights to carry a firearm or any kind of a weapon into the roundhouse now, which has been a standalone for our state. Well, not standalone. There's other states that do it, but it's been a big factor. And now they're wanting to take that away from us, including law enforcement officers. And they're sneaking around Peter Wirth and Brian Engoff. They're doing this behind our backs, basically. Nobody even hardly knows that this meeting is taking place today. And by the end of the day, they could have passed this, and nobody understands how it's legal. Is it going to be legislative? Is it going to be policy or whatever? But they're actually up there behind closed doors violating our rights as New Mexico citizens to go in our house.
Yeah. Well, the part that gets me is what in the history of the last couple of years have you seen where we think it's a good idea to start disarming people, not, you know what I mean?
Yeah, arming them.
I'm just saying, you know, and I don't care what people's thoughts one way or other on what happened at the Capitol building, but, you know, people are there to protect themselves, and if they're armed and protect, how many less things would have happened if someone, you know what I mean? Look at Albuquerque right now, and it's just been in the news a lot lately where businesses are tired of being robbed day in and day out by the same people, and they're protecting themselves. And they put some people on notice with this. And you got some people saying, oh, but most of us, I think, are like, good for them. Mm-hmm. I think, there's always a loud minority. But for the most part, most people support this. And they're like, no, it's time for us to take back what's ours and protect the things that we've worked hard for and protect those that we care about. And I think the fact that these robberies in Albuquerque that we see on the news now, and now there's business owners and gun owners saying, oh, yeah, you're going to do this? Well, guess what? We have rights, too, and we're going to enforce them as well, and they're doing it. And it looks like the law enforcement and courts and everything are saying, you're well within your right to do that.
And, in most places, that's true.
And I hope to God that doesn't go away, but I ain't going to lie. The closer, the more we go, the older I get, the more worried I get to wonder if that's going to be the way of the world, or is it going to be where they're prosecuting the people that all they're doing is trying to protect their rights and their people and their businesses and freedoms.
If people don't wake up and start getting involved, and I'm talking mainly gun rights right now, but it's everything.
Mm-hmm.
The problem we got now is complacency and apathy. And that's what's killing this country right now and everything. But as far as gun rights, you know, I know a lot of people that aren't even NRA members or New Mexico State or New Mexico Shooting Sports Association members. You know, it costs less than a box of ammo to join those. And I know there's some issues with the NRA, but we've got to fix the NRA. We need a strong NRA. But just to give you an example of what you're talking about, we've got gun sales that have increased every year for 3 years. We're selling 23 million guns a year last year, and most of them are going to, now that they've done some survey work, National Shooting Sports Foundation is finding that it's mostly women.
Yeah.
And they're buying these firearms to protect themselves. They're realizing that, yes, we're very pro-law enforcement, but when something happens, they're minutes away. And, you know, you're the first responder. You've got to be ready to take care of yourself.
Well, I mean, you look at this country and we look at, you know, we're a capitalist country and we're looking and I really think our laws kind of go and dictate and the market kind of dictates where we should go with some of these things. And clearly those numbers right there alone tell you how Americans feel about firearms. Yeah. They want them. They want the ability to own them. And this is the thing. We all have a responsibility once you are a gun owner, and that's the thing. As long as as long as people that are buying guns do what you're supposed to do with it, then we don't have a problem. And that's the thing is we got to educate everybody and at the same time make sure that right never goes away, because that's the line in the sand. If they take away your ability to defend yourself, then they take away your ability to fight back.
Without the Second Amendment, you haven't got any amendments.
That's the whole point of the Second Amendment. Exactly. And you look at the Constitution is the most amazing document on the planet. The Constitution with the Bill of Rights and the amendments to it, it's got everything we need to run our government. It tells everything exactly on what we can do and what we cannot do. And that has been so misinterpreted and misconstrued by both political parties, in my opinion, since the Civil War.
And judges and everything else.
And yep. we need to put that back in check. We need to, you know, the checks and balances are skewed. And certainly in the state of New Mexico, I don't know if they've ever been right, but, but that's the problem why we have here. It's, and I don't care if you're extreme liberal, extreme conservative, or somewhere in between. In your government, you need that balance, because without the balance, there's nobody to run checks on the other. And if you don't have that checks and balances, then bad government gets out there. Much of the legislation you're seeing with the gun legislation, with a lot of things, is because it's coming from a one-sided agenda. And that's the big problem. And I know we're talking guns here, and I'm getting way into another political area, but it's all connected. And I get it. People, you know, going to be conservative this way, but I'm just like, I want to get New Mexico back to the middle just so we at least have some good government that comes out of the Santa Fe here.
Well, and gun rights... Your ability to protect yourself and gun rights really is not a partisan issue. I mean, it's not Democrat, it's not Republican or independent. This is your right as an American citizen, your God-given right.
Yeah.
And to defend yourself, and not to mention the recreational aspects of it. I mean, there are, I don't know how many, for example, our 4-H program here in this county, we've got kids shooting shotguns and pistols and rifles and archery. They're learning hand-eye coordination, they're learning respect, responsibility.
Absolutely.
And it's there's nothing negative about it, except for the people that want to try to make it negative and want to control you. Yeah, it's all about control.
A firearm is a tool and nothing more. And and I say this every time, and it's okay, take away the guns. You're not taking away the problem. The guns are gone.
Exactly.
They're going to go to the next thing. What are you going to ban next? Knives? Oh, wait a minute. there's a run of people with killing with plungers. Are we going to start taking away plungers? I mean, that's, you got to fix the mental health.
If a drunk driver kills somebody in their car, you know, you want to take away their
automobile. Exactly. Yeah. We're going to all not drive anymore because that's the logic they're telling us on guns.
There's a few bad apples in it. You know, our police forces have a few bad apples, but you don't want to, I mean, some people want to take away our police forces, but I certainly don't. I don't know what we'd do without law enforcement, proper law enforcement.
Be careful what you wish for. You don't want that. But, yeah, I mean, yeah, we'd all don't. But I think that's the one thing, you're right. We can agree on that. It's all about how you treat it, how you about and I'm okay with education and things like that. You know, that's part of it. If you're, and this is the thing, if you look, and this is why gun owners get so mad when they see other gun owners do things irresponsibly, because it makes you all look bad, because everyone knows it's, and I'm not getting into the political thing with the Alec Baldwin. I know everyone's got their ramifications on there, but you can hear what constantly people that are gun owners and gun people are saying. If they do the things that's 101 gun safety, that would have never happened.
Exactly.
And that's the point where that they're saying is, guns do not hurt anybody if you go by the protocols and do. There's no accidental.
No different than a rake or a shovel.
No one will accidentally die if you follow procedure. And they missed about 20 different things in that 5 minutes of exchange right there that caused the unfortunate accident that happened on that set. And that's all there is to it. Because if that gun was truly cold, three people would have known about it before it got to Alec Baldwin's hand, because they were supposed to check it every time, and nobody did.
Well, if you just had something simple, you know, he's been an anti-gunner for I don't know how long. If you had, very simple, I'm a certified firearms instructor, hire people like us. Mm-hmm. If I'd have been on that set, that never would have happened. And I don't mean to sound conceited or whatever, but there's just certain things, if you follow, that does not happen.
That was a tragedy of budget cuts.
Yes.
That movie... That you ever hear the term, you get what you pay for? Unfortunately, that was a prime example of that statement right there. If you cut corners, and it sounds like it was a low-budget film. They were trying to make it under a certain amount, so they're like, where can we cut corners? Oh, we're going to buy we're going to hire the armorer that's thousands of dollars less than all the other armorers, despite, there's probably, I'm sure it's fine. Well, guess what? It probably wasn't fine. And I'm sure, we don't know all the details yet, but I'm going to guess something along those lines will come out when this is all said and done.
Well, back to what's going on with gun rights. Just to kind of put you in perspective, you know, they can't do this legally. They can't do it through Congress because they can't get the votes. They can't do it through it probably will through our state legislature. We're fighting it. We're lucky to fight them all, but they got to go behind closed doors now. This meeting I'm talking about today, some of it may actually be, they've announced it might be behind closed doors.
Really? So you can't even watch it online?
No, you can't even watch and see what's going on. So this is the control that they're trying to make on our government. So it's not just a gun issue. This is a total control issue in this state. I'm, of course, focusing on the gun aspects of it, but it snowballs into everything. And like I say, you're right. The people do want our firearms, not just for protection, but we want it for recreational shooting, this and that. And then the Second Amendment was never written for hunting. It's not about hunting.
No.
It's about to protect ourselves. And in case of tyranny, that's what the Second Amendment is for.
Read the rest of these, those early Bill of Rights, those reading the whole amendment there and take up the search and seizures and all. That's all, you know, looking at what the British were doing to our colonists at that time, taking their homes and making them hold up for, that's why there's all that's in the Constitution and those things. Well, firearms, exact same thing. They're taking their guns and everything else. And you can't. And then the whole point of having a militia and having it is in case the government gets out of hand, the people should be armed to stop it. And that's the whole point of your right to bear arms.
And most people don't realize that the Revolutionary War, you know why that was started? Really? The British were trying to take away our powder storage.
Okay.
So coming for our powder was what really started the Revolutionary War.
When you hear
the
Lexington and Concord when they were going after all that. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, they obviously firearms would have been next if you haven't got gunpowder. But
sure.
That's what it was all about.
Yeah, without powder, the guns are useless.
But anyway, we're trying to fight this all. And the main thing I wanted to talk about today is we are going to have an NRA ILA meeting here.
Okay.
Wednesday, 6:30 at the Elks Club, and we're going to have a representative, Tara Micah from the NRA ILA here to talk to us about what's going to happen in this legislative session and answer questions and everything else. So we're trying to get as many people there as we can. But to give an example, right now, what we know is coming in 2020, and these are laws that we helped defeat last year. Last year, we were able to, we were involved, but there's a lot of people that stopped every single anti-gun proposal they had last year, including red flag enhancement laws. But here we go again this year. Because of one of the shootings in high school, they're coming up with what we think is going to be called Benny's Law.
Okay.
And it's a mandated storage law. So they want to come in your home and tell you how to store your firearms. Last year, when they were trying to do this, one of the things was if you had a revolver, they wanted your cylinder stored in one part of your house and the frame stored in another part of your house. So good luck when somebody comes crashing through your door and you want to defend yourself. Wait a minute, I could go
put my gun together. Yeah. Yeah. It's well, and to be honest, there's technology available out there that you can do the kind of protection that they're wanting without having to store one part of the gun in one part of the house and the other part in another house. They have safes and things that that no one accesses except for you, and you can get into it very quickly without anybody else, and it eliminates some of the things that they're trying to do.
It's not any of the government's business how you do that.
Well, and that's just it. That's the problem here. But here's the problem. And this is where we as the public have to educate ourselves. They're going to present these laws in ways that sound like, yeah, that's a good idea. Because on the surface, they're trying to tell you is that this way you can have your guns at home, but you can't, you know, accidentally do something because they're not stored in the same spot. Mm-hmm. But the problem is exactly what John was saying. That's not practical reason to own the gun. If people have a handgun, 9 times out of 10 it's for home protection, and generally speaking, when home protection goes on, the people in the home, they're not going to have time to go to one part of the house to get you know, the ammunition, and then another part of the house to get the gun, and then if they got a revolver with another part of the gun somewhere else.
That's not the government's business anyway.
Exactly, but that's what they're trying to tell you, like, oh, this is a safety thing, and it sounds pretty good on the surface, but when you start reading the nuts and bolts of it, it's more harm than good. And that's, unfortunately, all these guns and gun laws, especially ones that are naming so-and-so's law or blah, blah, blah's law, they're trying to pull at your heartstrings, and they're actually slowly eroding your rights by pulling your heartstrings. And that's how they're going to take our rights away. It's not going to be some big long mustache dude coming in saying the world is mine now. It's not going to be that way. It's going to be this. They're going to slowly take away. And by 20 years later, everything you commonly thought you could do, you can't do no more because they've slowly taken it away when you don't notice it. I'm on your nose.
Well, another thing they're trying to do that caused a lot of controversy last year, and we were able to stop it, is they want to give taxpayer dollars to anti-gun groups. So they want to take money that you and I paid in taxes, give it to somebody to take our rights away. They want taxpayer dollars.
Well, then, as long as you
to go to give anti-gun groups and take our rights away,
give the same amount of money to the pro-gun guys, and then I'm on board. But you know, government should not be in the business of deciding that kind of stuff. That's our job, our people.
Another thing they want to do is they want to enhance the red flag law. That, you know, that was very controversial. It still is a law. It did pass, but it was some of the troublesome stuff was taken out of it. For example, it was a law enforcement officer that had to serve red flag. Now they want to go back to where if your neighbor's mad at you and you do something wrong, he can red flag you.
Yeah.
So you got somebody that, you know, it's maybe their dog's pooping in your yard and you're mad at him. So you call somebody and say, this guy's not right. Maybe I want you to come and check him out. So they take your guns. Then they decide if you're innocent or guilty.
Remember back when they had the report your neighbors for doing COVID things wrong? Mm-hmm. Think of that, but with guns.
Exactly.
That's exactly what they're doing.
Yeah,
and you saw how that worked out and how that's what they're trying to do. Report your neighbor. And so instead of trying to fix a situation, they're giving it as a tool to be vindictive against neighbors that don't like each other. Yeah. And they're not forcing them to prove it. You know, just because you don't like them, now you can say, well, they're doing illegal stuff with guns
exactly.
over there.
Law enforcement hasn't got time for that. They've got enough of the real thing.
Well, that's the problem, too, is they make all these wonderful laws, but there is no way that the law enforcement and everyone can enforce these things. They don't have the budget, the equipment, or anything to do that.
Well, and they're not needed. Let's take red flag law, for example. Sure. There have been five times, you know, we had to have that, according to them. It was, we're going to die without it. So we get red flag law. There have only been five instances where it's been brought up. One of them was immediately thrown out. The other four have not been settled yet, but it looks like none of them are going to have charges associated with them. Universal background check, the same way. There's not been one charge since we passed universal background check. So we tried to tell them they're both needless laws. Law enforcement tried to tell them, you know, they don't have time to mess with this.
Sure. And there really is already pretty good laws in place.
Oh, they're
do it, but exactly. We just got to enforce them and use them.
And that's the problem.
Yeah.
And then when you do enforce them, they crooked judges let them out. You know, purchasing a firearm is a good example. You fill out a 4473. If you lie on that form, it's a felony. Well, under Obama's administration and somewhat Biden's too, they've had numbers like under Biden's administration, Obama's administration, they were bragging, oh, we've had 46,000 people lie on a 4473. So those should all be felons. You know how many they prosecuted? Three.
Three of them.
In his whole administration, three of them were prosecuted.
Yeah. So. Well, whose fault is that?
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
It's like, hey, here's the thing in place to prevent this from happening, and you're not doing anything about it.
Well, one thing I wanted to say, too, most people, there's some people that are upset with the NRA right now, and rightly so. I am, too. But we need a strong NRA to fight this. And the NRA ILA, the ILA branch of it is Institute for Legislative Action. And they're not a separate organization. They're under NRA, but they're kind of separate. Chris Cox ran that. These are the good guys. They weren't involved with any of this stuff that's going on with the NRA. They're the ones that are helping us fight for our legislative rights and everything else. So we need their help as much as they need our help. So,
is there some kind of almost like civil war within the NRA going on right now?
Or yeah, that's a whole long story.
I'm not very familiar with all of it, so I don't know all the details.
Well, if we got time to get in it, I can get into it. But
is there a short version or?
Yeah, the short version is we've got Wayne LaPierre needs to go.
Gotcha.
He and I had a hard time accepting that. I've met him. I've talked to him several times, but a lot of it has been litigated now, so it's not a rumor. He's violating funds. We had Agnes and McQueen running the NRA, and
gotcha.
Agnes McQueen was basically running Wayne LaPierre. We've got a lot of crooked board members on there.
Gotcha.
There's a good chance now. Letitia James, the attorney for New York, attorney general, is trying to abolish the NRA. She wants that feather in her hat, but right now it looks like she's maybe going to be able to do that.
Well, the kind of nonsense that's like going, that's the thing they've been waiting for to put on the radar to
get and people will probably go to jail.
Yeah.
Well, and then she may abolish the NRA and we may have to try to start it all over again, but we do need a strong NRA. If we'd had NRA not going through all this during this last election, things could have been different because NRA was basically absent.
Yeah.
But again, that's part of that is we've got to get involved too. And that's part of what this meeting will talk about. So we need people, you know, I don't know how many gun owners we have in Chavez County.
I'm willing to bet pretty good number.
I would be willing to bet too. And I bet a lot of them own more than one firearm, but we have things like this. And sometimes we get 50 people show up at that much. And people think that's a good attendance, but I don't. I would like to see a lot more involved.
Town of 50,000. You like to see a good percentage of them here or at least plugged in some way, shape, or form.
Yeah, because it's time to wake up. People don't realize how close we are. I mean, there are a lot of legislators that want to take state and federal. They do not want us to own a firearm.
Well, I say this in the world we live in today, where there's a lot of people trying to pull you in a lot of different directions to see their things and see their views. The only way you can protect yourself from all that is to educate yourself, and it's to do your own research, attend meetings, hear what's being said, hear what's going on. You're going to use the internet. Be careful, but use the internet, because the internet's a very powerful tool. You're going to find a lot of garbage, and you're going to find some good stuff. But you got to educate yourself on what's out there, and you need to know what's legitimate concern versus what is just head-turning, trying to look at me and distract you kind of stuff, because unfortunately there's a whole lot of that going on too, where it's like, look at this ridiculousness. And while everyone's up in outrage about this ridiculous, the real problems going on behind them, the old sleight of hand I feel that we're in a world where there's a lot of that going on.
Well, right, and in Chavez County too, we're lucky in Chavez County. We got a sheriff in Chavez County. There's a constitutional sheriff.
Yes, sir.
We also have all of our representatives have fought extremely hard for not only our gun rights, but all our rights. They're doing a great job.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of it too. People here don't realize that we still got to be involved.
Mm-hmm.
They got, even the pro-gun legislatures, they need to hear from us. They need to understand that we're backing them, how we feel. And we're fortunate. I put on one of these the year before last, and we're so fortunate. Almost all of our representatives and some of our senators from the surrounding area, and our sheriff, they were all there. They all showed up. They're interested in this.
We have good people fighting for us in Santa Fe. We just don't have enough of them.
Exactly. That's the problem. Yeah, they're outnumbered. You know, people criticize. They say that our politicians aren't doing enough in some cases, but they don't understand.
Sure.
You know, for example, the governor, a lot of people are saying that they ought to do more to get rid of our governor.
Right.
Well, if they hadn't voted for the legislative procedure right now, that where you've got to have a majority of the legislature, that's the only way we can get rid of our governor is by a legislative majority. Well,
yeah.
As long as we've got, we're so upended, we got so many Democrats in there that, you know, they haven't got a chance.
Yeah. It's my only hope here is that the progressive side there alienates the moderates so bad that they're forced to.
That's happened nationally,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, I think that's the trend we're going to have to see here for that to start making an indent into that stuff. It's just because it's almost like you got to give them more rope to hang themselves to get everyone to see how just bad what they're doing is right now. And I'm like, well, how much longer can we do that before the ship sinks? You know, it's a slippery slope right now. It's very scary times. So we the people need to educate ourselves. Go to this meeting, be informed, understand what your rights are and what's happening out there. And that's the thing. Even if you're like don't care one way or another about guns, you're like I don't have a lot of experience, but you got to understand on what your rights are there, because at some point you may want one and you may want to go down that path. And if you don't educate yourself now, you're not going to be able to make that decision down the road. They may make it so that owning a gun is so hard that you got a better chance of, you know.
There's hundreds and hundreds of stories right now. You can read them in all kinds of different publications where, like I say, women that are first-time gun owners,
mm-hmm.
that's why they're buying them. They know that they're trying to take our gun rights away. They want them used to protect themselves, and that's why gun sales are increasing every year.
We don't have a gun problem in this country. We have a mental health problem
exactly.
in this country. The guns are a tool that's being used by people with mental health problems.
Well, and it's not just mental health. It's improper use.
Sure.
It's like you say, a gun is a tool. It's like a rake or a shovel.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen a gun laying on a table get up and shoot somebody.
Exactly.
It always takes a person to activate the firearm, just like it would take somebody to activate a knife,
sure,
a rake, a crowbar, or whatever.
It's like when you're using your knives in your kitchen. You know, you're not spinning them around or doing dumbness. You pick it up, you cut it. Guns are the exact same way. You do the same treatment to those, and it's a tool like anything else. And that's all it is.
Yeah.
And that's why I always say the mental health problem, because the school shootings, that's not a gun problem. That's people with mental health issues. If there was not one single gun on the planet, those same people would be in there with a bomb or a box cutter or who knows, a can of gas and a match. Who knows?
Exactly.
They're going to find something else equally destructive or more destructive, because that's what their mind's at and their heart's set at. Whether guns are on this planet or not, it doesn't make a difference what's going to happen there.
You're right. And it's so simple. And if people, a lot of it's just common sense, but
yeah.
They've got legislators lying to them. They got people lying to them and some people just don't realize and they don't do enough research to understand this is not the truth. This is not the problem.
Yeah.
They don't want to solve the real problem, because if a real problem was solved, it would put a lot of our legislators in a really bad light.
Well, yeah, if a lot of our problems are solved, we need a lot less lawyers and a lot less politicians, and no one wants more of either. So
yeah.
I just saw the time. John, what's like I said, let's give the details out on this meeting here Wednesday for dates, times, and all that good stuff.
Okay, it's going to be Wednesday, November 3rd, the day after our election. Mm-hmm. So this coming Wednesday.
Yeah.
And it's going to be at 6:30 at the Elks Lodge on Montana Avenue.
Okay.
If anybody has any questions, they can call me at 626-3974.
All right.
I guess as of last Sunday, you're going to have to dial the area code
575, throw that in there, yeah.
So we're... Again, we're going to have our NRA ILA representative there. We're going to have some of our legislators there. We're going to talk about the upcoming legislative session. It'll be a chance to get some questions answered and
yeah, educate yourself.
Let your voice be heard.
And in the meantime, go to the New Mexico Shooting Sports Association website. It's nmssa.org. Or if you don't remember any of that, just Google New Mexico Shooting Sports Association, something, some combination thereof, and it'll pop right up. And then you can learn a little bit more about the Shooting Sports Association as a whole, what it's about. And then if you would like to get more involved with promoting and educating and fundraising and all the stuff that's needed to get the word out there, I'm sure there's lots of information.
Please join. You know, we couldn't have our fundraiser last year because of COVID and all this effort that we're doing costs money, so we really need members. So, yeah, it's like I say, it's less than a box of shells. So
use it as a resource to educate yourself and to educate others. And, of course, if you want to get involved more to spread the word and spread the education, and really that's what this organization is about, spreading the education, spreading the information, promoting shooting sports is a fun thing. But right now the mission's kind of shifted to educating on what gun rights and what guns – can do and can't do, and how we should treat them and we as a society and how we should interact with them, because you have a right to bear arms. But in order to keep that right, we all have to be good stewards of the arms. And that's how our society works.
Freedom isn't free.
Freedom is not free. The freedom only works when we're responsible with it. And there's There's always going to be people that are knuckleheads and screw that up. You can't stop that. That's just going to be, you know, if there's humans on the planet, there's going to be some good ones and some bad ones. That's just how humans are. But the good ones need to, the worst thing you can do is nothing sometimes.
Yeah.
And you need to educate yourself. You need to equip yourself with all this information and spread the word. So come out to this meeting. Do your research. If you're not available Wednesday, reach out to John or out and say, hey, I'd love to get more involved. I can't come out Wednesday, but I'd love to get more involved. How can I do that? Reach out. There's resources for
you. And please, everybody, today, ring the phones off the wall. Call Egoff and Worth and tell them we do not want this. We do not want our rights violated behind closed doors, sneaking around, because you can't do it through the legal system.
Yeah. You want to do things behind closed doors, and you can do them out in the open, because that's how our government
flood their phone. That meeting starts at 1:30 today.
Yep. If it's too, the only reason they should be behind closed doors, any government, if it's a legal matter where they're talking to their lawyers and they're going to go to court about it, because they have that right too.
Right.
And personnel, because you don't want people's personnel stuff. Other than that, there shouldn't be any government committees or anything in a closed doors.
Open government policy.
Exactly. You should be able to walk into that room, kick your feet up, and say, what's going on in here? Yeah. And that's, anyway, another story. John, is there anything we missed? Did we get it all?
I think we've got it. Just please show up Wednesday. We'd like to have that place packed.
Awesome. Well, thank you, sir. And anytime. We'll see you next time here. And hopefully we're coming in one day and we're talking about good news. Like, hey, we made ground here. We're starting to make some progress here.
Oh, and just one more thing real quick. Remember, this is sign up month for 4-H shooting sports. So if you want your kids involved in our 4-H shooting sports, get them signed up this month.
Yeah, go talk to Andrew over at the extension office. She'll get you taken care of. And if that's not your thing, there's about 57 other different great activities that 4-H has for you. So awesome. Well, thank you, John.
All right.
Appreciate the visit as always. We'll see you next time. All right.